Lobo.
We're very happy to have here Holden Grau. She's Google, Microsoft, Amazon, Databricks, and now it's IBM, doing mostly things with Spark all over the place. And she's not here in Barcelona, so welcome.
Spark is mostly that it's secretly 300 gnomes hiding inside of a data center. This depends, of course, on the size of your support contract with your vendor, how many gnomes you receive. If you go for the premier level, you get 300 small gnomes working on your data science problems. I'm Colton. My preferred pronouns are she or her. I've worked at a lot of companies, as was mentioned, which is a really nice way of saying I don't hold jobs for very long. And actually, this job right now is getting close to being my longest job. We're 1 month away from the 18-month mark. Things you can only get away with in San Francisco. And I'm an Apache Spark committer, which means I contribute code to Spark, and I mostly focus on trying to make the Python interface for Spark work well, which is why I love talking to Python people. Also, the fact that you are all super friendly really helps out. If you want to follow me on Twitter for a Canadian who is somehow stuck living in America right now, and really confused about that, you can find me on Twitter. You can also buy several copies of my books. I recommend that to everyone. And the slides from today's talk will end up on SlideShare. Normally, I have a co-presenter. Her name is Boo. She's very cute. She even has a special outfit for this talk. But she was very sleepy this morning, / I forgot her in bed, so she's not with me. But just pretend that Boo is here, and things will be okay. Sorry, Boo's not here. So I added this slide because I give a lot of my talks in America after the most recent election. And just in case you don't know other people like me, I'm trans, I'm queer, I'm Canadian, I'm on a work visa in America. One of the ones they're talking about reforming, which is just delightful to be on a work visa, they're going to change. And I also consider myself a part of the other community. And I write the same shitty code that everyone here writes. I'm not like stealing jobs or doing anything evil. I don't know what your television says about people like me. But in America, maybe sometimes it says some bad things, and I think it's important to remember that at the end of the day, we all write code that calls Fortran code, and we want to pretend we don't. It doesn't matter who you are. So I work at IBM's Spark Technology Center in San Francisco. We have a lot of green. I'm told this is a good slide for convincing people to work for us. Not so sure about that. But we have 50 developers, and we all work on sort of open source stuff. I'm probably the most Python-focused person in our group, but we also have a few other people. Brian has been working a lot on integrating Arrow with Spark, and looking at the Python interfaces on that side. If you buy things from IBM, like support contracts or mainframes, please keep doing that. I'm told that System Z pays my salary and System 360 covers the overhead, which is a nice way of saying my manager and the office space. So if anyone works at a bank, please renew your support contracts. If you don't, I mean, whatever, you're probably not going to buy a mainframe. But, you know, you can. So I'm hoping you're nice people. I'm hoping you know some Python. If you don't, sorry. The examples are in Python, but hopefully you can read it anyways. I'm curious, how many people have some experience with Apache Spark? That's pretty amazing. Oh my god, okay. How many people have, like, no experience with Apache Spark? I think I see some of the same hands. I'm very confused. But okay, we'll roll with that. Hopefully this doesn't scare you away from using Spark, but if it does, I understand. Just don't tell my boss. We're going to talk about sort of how Spark works. And it's important to note that while a lot of this does look like baling wire and twine and duct tape, somehow it still works. So this should not scare you away. So what is Spark? It's a general purpose distributed computing system, which is a fancy way of saying that we can take Lambda expressions and run them over your data. And you can use it to do pretty much whatever you want, provided that you don't do something completely crazy. Please don't write software that murders me. Although, I mean, it's a general purpose distributed system, so you could write software that murders me. Just don't. It has sort of these two core abstractions, RDDs and what are called data frames or data sets. And these are both essentially just magical distributed collections which distribute our data and our work across the 300 gnomes and make sure that each gnome has a piece to work on or a few pieces to work on and coordinates the results for us. And it allows us to pretend that the 300 gnomes don't exist and we just have one really big gnome or computer. So why do people find Spark? I think a lot of people find Apache Spark when they're like, okay, so I can't load my pandas data frame anymore, and I've bought the largest Amazon instance I can, and I don't want to buy an IBM mainframe for some reason. And then they come to Spark. Of course, the IBM salespeople will tell you the right answer is IBM mainframe, and far be it from me to get in their way. But if for some reason you don't have a few million dollars sitting around for a mainframe, Spark can provide a reasonable alternative. The other way that a lot of people will find Spark is they're running a MapReduce job. How many people have worked with MapReduce? Okay, that's a good number of people. I'm very sorry. But the other one is a lot of people run MapReduce jobs, then they kick off their MapReduce job and they see it's going to take like 16 hours or 24 hours, and they're like, that's kind of crazy. What am I going to do with my next 16 hours? Maybe I'll try and figure out a way to make this job faster. And then they were like, oh, Spark is like a faster alternative to MapReduce. Maybe I can learn it before my job is finished. And sometimes you can learn enough Spark in the amount of time it takes your MapReduce job to finish to rewrite your MapReduce job. And I think that's kind of cool. This says more about MapReduce than Spark, though. No offense to any MapReduce developers in the room. And there's a little bit of magic. Some people come to Spark because they're like, I like functional programming. Are there any functional programming nerds in the house? Yay! Friends! Okay, so some people come to Spark because they're like, I like functional programming. I want to trick my boss into using functional programming, but every time I tell him this, or I tell them this, they say no. But if I tell them that I want to use Spark, they're like, that sounds amazing. I read about it in the magazine. And this is a really good way of tricking your boss and your coworkers into doing functional programming. Because at the end of the day, Spark exposes these functional programming concepts, and this is sort of how we represent our distributed computation. So what is the magic of Spark? The core magic of Spark is that we have these automatically distributed collections that just work, with a lot of quotation marks around the word work. But this magic is powered by this thing called the directed acyclic graph. Like was being talked about earlier, a lot of these computations can be thought of as like sort of a dependency graph that we're implicitly representing by all of these sort of transformations that we're doing. So if we have a few maps that we do on an RDD or a distributed collection, we can think of this as building a graph that Spark is going to take and compile down and run for us. We also have data frames, and data frames use something called the query plan instead of the directed acyclic graph. I guess the directed acyclic graph people wish they were in math grad school, and the data frame people wish they were working on databases, hence the names for these different systems. But at the end of the day, they're pretty fundamentally similar. The resiliency is also really important in Spark. It's pretty easy to make a distributed system that isn't resilient. The only problem is it's useless. In a distributed system, failures are like a first-class citizen. When you have 300 gnomes, one of them is going to go off, find a tiny bottle of vodka, and get alcohol poisoning. And your results are going to be meaningless if you have to have all 300 gnomes at exactly the same time. So we need a way to handle gnome failure. These gnome jokes are not going over nearly as well as I thought they would, except there's one guy who's like really loving them. I'm sorry, I thought these gnomes would be more popular. But okay, so one of our computers can fail, and then we need to recover. And Spark achieves resiliency in a different way than MapReduce. MapReduce achieves resiliency by writing data out to a bunch of machines, and so if something goes wrong, it can just go and find a backup copy of the data that it wrote down. Spark, on the other hand, says, I'm actually making this query plan or this graph of my computation as I'm going. If one of my gnomes gets drunk, I'll just ask another gnome to do the work that that gnome was doing instead. And then we don't have to write data out to three different disks. So RDDs are resilient distributed data sets. We don't have to worry about them too much. We can just think of them as a magical collection which is automatically distributed across our cluster. Data frames are pretty much the same thing, except we have some schema information, and schemas are kind of cool, and we can do things inside of a DSL instead of using lambda expressions everywhere. So we can write like select statements instead of having dot map lambda x colon x dot coffee to find the number of coffees. And data sets are this compile time type version. If there's any secret Java people hanging out in the audience, it's okay, I won't rat you out, but you're going to see data sets in the Java and Scala documentation for Spark. So how does the data work, right? How do we build this graph of computation? So we take our RDDs, which represent some data, and this data may or may not exist. We really hope it does, but we don't really know for sure. And then we transform it. And so we do this with a functional programming thing like a map or a flat map. And then Spark gives us back a new RDD, and the new RDD says, my parent is this old RDD, and this is the thing that I need to do to get to who I am. It's really cool, it's awesome, and this also has this really interesting property of RDDs don't really exist in the way that we classically think of a collection existing. It doesn't have to ever exist, really. If we have a map followed by another map, and then we compute the data, Spark will actually see that we've got these two map expressions next to each other and sort of glue them together into a single pass. So the intermediate RDD won't necessarily have to exist. And this is important if one of your intermediate steps is technically too big to fit in memory, but like you reduce it down as you're going. And we're going to look at word count, because as a licensed big data instructor, I'm required to illustrate almost everything with word count. That's why it's in every fucking presentation. So here we've got a really simple DAG for some Spark transformations. We've got a really simple query plan. We can see that the DAG just says like different functional programming abstractions. We've got like map partitions, and stuff like this. And we can see that the query plan has a bit more information. You probably can't read it, but you can see there's things like whole stage code gen and hash partitions and stuff like this. And this is because the query plan has a bit of a better understanding of what the distributed data looks like, and we'll look at how this happens. But so there's a little extra information in sort of the query plan version of things. So this is Spark's word count example. I have to have it, otherwise they take away my license. So the first thing that we do is we load in our data, presumably from HDFS, but it could also be from any file system. We turn that into words with a flat map, and we go ahead and we make each word in the number one, and then we do a reduce by key, which says I want to take all of the things with the same word and combine them together, and then I save the result out. And this is really interesting because in Spark, until we call this save as text file thing, nothing has actually really happened. Spark hasn't had to load the data. Spark hasn't even verified that the data exists. Our intermediate lambda expressions haven't been shipped across the cluster. None of these things happen until we get to this action. And this is really important and useful because it means the optimizer is able to look at the things that we've done here and sort of glue those together and save us from having to put in a lot of time trying to combine the flat map and the map and the reduced by key. And so this is useful. On the other hand, it means that your error messages are going to make about 0 cents. And I'm sorry about that. To be fair, I haven't seen a general purpose distributed system with useful error messages yet. If you know of one, please tell me. I want to steal their code. But when you call save as text file, you hopefully get a result, and everything's written out to HDFS, and it's amazing. Except if you made a mistake, you get an error which says, like, there was an error somewhere. And at that point, you pour yourself a glass of coffee or something stronger if you're one of your drunken gnomes. I like vodka in my coffee. And then you go and you start debugging. But we're gonna pretend that our code works today, and we're not going to focus on debugging, because debugging makes people sad. And if we pretend our software works, I can get you to use it. What does this do? So we get to pipeline this, right? We can glue our map and our flat map together. And I keep saying this and no one looks impressed. That's okay, but if you've been inside of a system like MapReduce, you spend a lot of time trying to figure out how to glue all of your different stages together to minimize the number of passes you're doing over your data. But in Spark, because we have this really nice graph representing your computation, the optimizer can just magically do this for us. There are some limitations, though, and we'll talk about them soon. So where does it reach its limits? So the DAG in Spark can only see the different things that we're asking it to do. It can't see the inside of the lambda expressions we're passing in. So it can see that we've asked it to do a map or a flat map, or you asked it to combine data by a given key, but it doesn't know how we asked it to combine data. All it knows is we provided some general lambda expression. And this is really cool because it lets us do pretty much whatever we want, right? Like if I want a lambda expression using NumPy, I'm fine. I don't have to worry about Spark NumPy support. I can use whatever normal Spark code there is. But it has a downside because Spark really can't do introspection. If we do something really crazy inside of our map or inside of our group by, this can make things kind of sad for us. And we'll look at how we can make Spark very sad. Your data is magically distributed. There is a catch with this. It turns out that magic means that the 300 gnomes have this agreement about each gnome handling certain pieces of your data, and this is normally based on the key of your data, which is great until you actually have real data, because it turns out almost all data has key skew, especially when your client tells you they don't have key skew. That means they're lying. And so what happens is one of your gnomes is going to be like responsible for handling all of the null records, and that gnome is going to have a very sad day. And even if it drinks the full like liter of vodka, that gnome is probably not going to get you your answer. And so we have to occasionally help Spark out, because the magic of how our data is split up is limited by the fact that our data could be split up on the key. So let's look at this. So, right, here's gnomes. Okay, at least people find pictures of gnomes funny. If they don't find my talking about drunken gnomes funny, would people find a picture of a gnome holding an empty vodka bottle more funny? Okay, I'll work on the gnome thing. Right, so key skew to the anti-rescue. And so what happens is the magic of Spark automatically distributing our data for us breaks once we decide that we want to sort by key or do something like this. Then Spark says, okay, I'll sort by key. But then it samples the data, it tries to do a really good job, like it tries really hard, it's like the little engine that could. It tries to find a reasonable distribution of keys to give to each node. But if a single key has too many records, Spark isn't able to introduce a split on that. And this is because in Spark, the partitioner, or how we distribute our data, has to be deterministic on the key input. And this is why we make the gnome sad sometimes. So there are some workarounds, though. And the easiest workarounds are just adding some jump to the end of the key. The other workaround is waiting for Spark 2.3, where hopefully we'll fix some of these bugs. But, I mean, I've been saying that since Spark 1.6, so you might not want to trust me. We can sort our data inside of Spark, right? And this is really simple. This is my example of trying to figure out where to open an artisanal mustache wax shop in America, because I get really tired of programming sometimes, and I like to pretend that I could have a career outside of programming, and maybe it would be selling mustache wax to hipsters. And I see at least a few pretty respectable mustaches here, so it might actually end up being in Europe. But San Francisco's Mission District is really well represented for handlebar mustaches, right? And so if I try and sort my data of who has mustaches in San Francisco, in the United States, we'll see that the San Francisco zip code of the Mission District, or postal code, if you want to pretend to be European, is so well represented that we actually have too much data and that the gnome responsible for handling that partition is going to give up. It won't be able to keep track of how many awesome mustaches there are in San Francisco, and our job is going to fail. And this is really simple, but I also think like this is a really common thing to do in a distributed system, right? We tend to have keys with a lot of skew, and sorting by key is a pretty reasonable thing to expect your computer to be able to do, right? You're not used to calling sort on a distributed collection failing. It's just not normal, except in Spark. But it's okay. We can get around this. We can just add some junk to the end of our key, and then Spark is able to figure out, okay, I can make these splits happen, and everything is fine. And I figure out that, I really should be opening my mustache wax shop in San Francisco's Mission District. And so we see these splits. And this works. Yay. Okay. But it's okay. We can make this magic break even worse. So we can have key skew, and then we can also have this problem of the black boxes that I was talking about earlier, right? Spark can't see inside of our lambda expressions to see exactly what we're asking it to do. It can only see a vague outline of what we're asking it to do. So the optimizer has some limitations. So we could do word count poorly, and we're going to do that together. We're actually going to do a word count which fails. So here's a bad word count. You can tell because the cat is about to get very wet and very pissed off. So we'll pretend we already have our data, and I'm going to tokenize it again with my high-quality English tokenizer. I like to pretend that languages without spaces for token separation don't exist. It works pretty well in America, and occasionally I have to internationalize my code, and then it's time to find a new job, which is why these jobs last 18 months. And then we go ahead and we make these word pairs, and then we group it together by key. And this seems like a pretty reasonable operation. And then I go ahead and I sum the counts for each word. That's pretty reasonable. But you might have noticed that the cat is about to get very wet and kind of pissed off, so there's clearly a problem here. What is our problem? So here's an example using kilobytes of data, so it would actually succeed. We can see that group by key has a shuffled write of even slightly larger than its input. So if we read here, generally speaking, when you have something like that happen, that is a sign that things are going to go poorly. Because big data becomes bigger data becomes out of memory exception. And this is pretty close to having an out of memory exception, except for the fact that that's a K rather than a G. So what do we do instead? So instead of using group by key, where Spark can't see what we're doing inside of the map values expression, right? Like here, we've got this lambda counts sum. Spark has no idea what kind of operation we're doing inside of there. So it can't pipeline this part. It doesn't know that we could compute this sort of eagerly and reduce the data as we were going. So instead, we use something like reduce by key or aggregate by key, where we tell Spark, like, yeah, I want all of this data together by key, but you don't have to like make this really big list of data. We can just start reducing it as I'm reading the data in, right? And this is really useful and important, and it means that these jobs will actually succeed. Reduce by key is the simplest type signature. Aggregate by key has a slightly more confusing signature, but it allows the types to be not exactly the same. And if you're a Hadoop person, you can think that you get a free map side reduce, and you can put that in like the big like free bubble that you see in the advertisements. Order today. And we can see reduced by key here, the stuff actually goes down in size slightly. And that's from our free map side reduce. What happens is each of the nomes takes a look at the list of data it has and tries to see if it can compute any of the sums locally first. And then it shuffles that result to the other nomes as one of these to compute it. So the amount of data going across the network decreases. And this is really awesome. No one's impressed. Okay, so one of the fixes to this not being able to understand what is going on for Spark is to write in a DSL that Spark can understand. This has got some really nice parts. It means that I don't have to spend a lot of time thinking about like how to write my reduce by key or aggregate by key step. I can just use a group's data frame, and then I can choose one of Spark's aggregates, and this will be awesome and magical. It also means that the optimizer gets to see a whole bunch of really extra cool things, and it can do things like filter pushdown. So if I'm only using some of the data, it can push down that filter to the storage layer and only load the pieces of data that I need, which I think is really cool. And we can always run back to the RDD land and write our arbitrary lambda expressions if we need to. And we also get free magic code gen. It's not normally Fortran, but occasionally it is. And then if it breaks, I'm sorry. Let's look at doing word count a third time. So exciting. So we can say that I love pandas. Pandas are like pretty much my jam. So I'm interested in tokenizing some information about pandas. And so in data frames, I can write a select statement. And I can do df.select, and then I can turn it into an RDD and have my high-quality tokenization function. And then I can go ahead, turn this back into a data frame, and then I can compute my sum using Spark's data frame. And we can look at the performance. We can see, so bigger is bad, smaller is good. So we can see that the bad example we talked about was very bad. It takes a very long time to run. The reduce by key or aggregate by key option performs reasonably well, but the data frame version performs even better. And this is actually done in Scala code to make it a somewhat fair-ish comparison for reduce by key. And we'll show you how the difference in Python comes out, because at the end of the day, Spark is actually written in Scala. And I'm sorry. It pains me more than it pains you, I promise you. As someone responsible for maintaining the Python bindings, I am reminded every day that I run on top of the JVM. and this comes at a cost. And this is where our final piece of magic for the day is going to come from. And this is the magic that lets PySpark work. And this is pretty cool magic. Spark is written in Scala, but it turns out that most people don't really want to use Scala. Unless they're like grad students. So Python, yay! If there's R people in the house, you don't have to raise your hands, I understand, hostile environment. But like, know that we're here for you too, R people. But I'm going to be honest, like, Python people heart, and it's like our people heart, but like, it's okay. If there's anyone from Microsoft in the room, they can tell you how they made this work with C#. Is there anyone from Microsoft in the house? And zero. Okay, well, so this apparently works in C# as well, and I don't know how. But essentially, PySpark answers the question of how expensive could inter-process communication be? And the answer is kind of expensive. So the PySpark internals look a lot like this playground, which would not be allowed in America, because there would be a lot of lawsuits. But maybe it's allowed here, I don't know. So what does the magic look like? Okay, how many people have used Py4j? One person. Okay, one and a half. Normally there's more people, and then we get to have a support group afterwards with drinks and like talking about how Py4j actually really loves us. It's just right now they're not in a space where they're ready. But I should not be harsh on the Py4j people. So Py4j is this wonderful library that allows you to call Java from Python. It uses a gigantic amount of reflection inside of the JVM, which is a little slow, and also occasionally breaks. And its error messages are delightful. Normally, the error message that you get from Py4j when you do anything wrong is, it's like, object is not callable. That can mean the package doesn't exist, the object is not actually callable, the object doesn't exist, or my class path doesn't make sense anymore. And hopefully that made sense to none of you, and the two of us will have drinks later. So Py4j is used so that the Python driver program, the part where you're going to write your happy Python code, can talk to this monstrosity of Scala code and ask it to do terrible things for us. And we take the lambda expressions that you make in Python, we pickle them, we send them over to the JVM, and then the JVM sends them to some worker programs which take them and do some work. If this sounds insane, it is. But it works! Sorry, I was told that I can't do my evil scientist laugh anymore. But this is what the architecture diagram looks like, which mostly proves that I don't have a designer working with me. But we can see that our driver program uses this Py4j bridge, and on our workers, we have Unix pipes to copy both the lambdas and the data from the JVM into Python. And then we do all of our actual work inside of Python. So how does this break, right? Like, clearly something is going wrong here. This architecture diagram does not make sense. We've got to be paying some price for doing this much crazy bad things to computers. The biggest one is that we have to serialize both our lambda expressions multiple times and our data multiple times. It turns out serializing lambda expressions a few extra times, that's like pretty much free. Serializing your data twice, it turns out not to be free, which was sad. But it turns out you can just buy twice as many computers because we scale all horizontally. And that's fine because I work for a hardware vendor. And we would love it if you used twice as many computers. But it actually, like, it's not that bad. You don't literally need twice as many computers, but you maybe need 20% more computers. The other part is error messages make no sense. To be fair, they wouldn't make a lot of sense even without this, but they make an extra little bit less of sense, so that's fine. And so this is what the gnomes look like inside of this Py4j bridge. This is, for example, caching an RDD, which is telling Spark that I want to use data multiple times. This isn't actually meant to make sense. This is just to illustrate that most of PySpark is really just some gnomes talking to some other gnomes and trying its best to hide the fact that we have the JVM underneath. So all of these underscore J things are where the JVM is, and it's that. Right, and now our magical happy data frame land. So here we can really see the cost of the double serialization in PySpark. And that is, you notice that reduced by key here is not performing as well as reduced by key in the other scatter slide. And that's really coming down to this double serialization cost. It's okay, though. You can just buy more machines and I'll be very happy. Or you could use data frames and I'll be less happy. But your code will run faster, because what happens with data frames is we take your SQL-like expressions or your expressions in Spark's DSL, and we compile it down to the JVM JIT, and we run it, and we don't have to copy the data around. And it's magic. Except when it doesn't work, and then, fine. So what is the future? I promised there was going to be some happy things in this talk as well, otherwise it was just going to be a bunch of really sad shit. So our future is actually bright. Thanks to things like Arrow, I think we actually have a really bright future. Arrow makes it possible for us to do really nice things and avoid spending a lot of time serializing stuff as pickled bytes. I also have this other crazy idea, which I thought was really cool, which was using Jython. Has anyone used Jython? Zero people? Okay. One and a half. Damn it! Okay, well, it turns out that I couldn't trick anyone into including the Jython dependencies into Spark. Because they were like 100 minutes. And no one's going to use that. That pull request did not go over very well. But I got a slide. So I made this thing, and it made it go really fast. But it turns out that, here's how much faster it can go. So we can actually, if you're not using like fancy libraries, and you can actually do your evaluation in Jython, we could make Spark go really fast. It turns out the alternative of just like avoiding this problem entirely and using Arrow is much more popular than trying to include Jython inside of Spark. And so I think our future is very much we're going to have Arrow, and this data copy thing is going to get a lot less expensive because we can start talking in the same formats as each other. And this naturally restricts us, of course, to the data types that Arrow supports. So if you have some really weird custom object, you'll still have this expensive pickling. But you know, we can do this, and it'll be awesome. If anyone really wants to go ahead, there's a PR you can review. We're in the middle of releasing 2.2, so it's not going to go in now. But this one actually might make it into 2.3, and then we'll start to see some really nice performance improvements in Spark. And if you want to use Spark and you don't have like a support contract from IBM yet, and I don't know why you wouldn't, it's available on Conda Forge. And hopefully soon it'll be available on PyPy. They just approved our file size exception request yesterday, but my connection got delayed, so I didn't have a chance to upload it. But you can Conda install PySpark and have a party. If you find any bugs, I will blame the Conda Forge maintainers. Intel proven otherwise. So for the people that were new to Spark, I hope that my talk about 300 gnomes didn't scare everyone away. If it scared you all away, I'm very sorry. Please don't tell my boss. But there are some really nice videos. Paco has an amazing introduction to Spark video. If you have a corporate expense account, you can buy it from O'Reilly for $100. If you don't have a corporate expense account, you can go on YouTube. If you've got a corporate expense account, like Paco's a great person, please buy it for $100. If you don't, though, I mean, YouTube's pretty okay too. And I've got a bunch of other Spark videos. If you're using Spark and you're like, I'm trying to debug my Spark application, why does nothing make sense? Why is Cthulhu threatening to eat my soul? You can look at my debugging PySpark talk on YouTube, and hopefully that will be useful to you. There are also a lot of really wonderful Spark books. I say this as a co-author of many of these Spark books, so I'm pretty biased. But I am not a co-author of Learning PySpark, although I do owe the co-authors some beer. So if you want to buy Learning PySpark from Denny Lee and Thomas, I don't know how to say his last name, It's a great book, I'm sure. Also, I call them some beers. There are also some other books. They are less Python focused, but I think they're still pretty useful, in part because I get money from them. My first Spark book, please do not buy it. It's called Fast Data Processing with Spark. It is for Spark 0.7. That is a long time ago. Spark does not look a lot like it did in Spark 0.7. But I have a new book where I receive higher royalties. And so I'm very excited about this new book. And it even has a chapter mostly on how to make Python and Spark work together without pulling out all of what's left of your hair. So it also has this really nice property of not really existing, which makes it an excellent gift, because it's an e-gift. If for some reason you insist on waiting for the physical copy, it'll be like a month or two, and you can buy it on Amazon. It's really too late to fix any mistakes in it, but if you find any mistakes, you could let me know, and I'll fix them for the reprint, I guess, and I'll owe you a beer, or coffee, as choice may be. This only applies to people in the room. This does not apply to strangers on the internet. Because there are going to be a lot of typos. Right. And I have some other upcoming talks. If there's any secret Scala nerds in the house, I will be at Scala Days. I will also be at Spark Summit West and Berlin Buzzwords. I don't remember what I'm talking about there, but I'm sure it's very useful, and you should all come. And Scala Swarm in Porto, if you want an excuse to go Porto. And I'll be at Scala London literally on Monday. If you're looking for an excuse to visit London, although I'm not sure why you would. London is great. Yeah. So that's pretty much it for me. I hope I've saved enough time for questions. I hope someone has questions, otherwise this is going to be awkward because I forgot my stuffed animal. I normally just hug them when no one has questions, but does anyone have questions? Anyone? Yay, one question.
Hi, thank you very much for your talk. It was very amusing, very interesting talk. Sorry.
Can you hear me? That was the best question.
Can you comment a little bit more about the status of the Jython project? Because when I last heard news about it, it was not very active. But now that you are trying to include it, I don't know, maybe there's some revival of the project or is getting some new attention.
Could you repeat that for me? I'm sorry.
Yeah, sorry. If you can comment a little bit more about the status of the Jython project.
Oh yeah. Okay. Right. The Jython in Spark project is pretty much dead. I mean, if you're excited about it, like I will help you out with that. But like, no one thought it was a good idea. I tried my hardest to trick people. I tried to hide how big the dependencies were going to be, and like no one fell for it. In part, actually, no one fell for it because the benchmarks that I used were all sort of made up bullshit. And this is because no one shared with me their Python UDFs. And I have this really wonderful survey link where you can share your Python UDFs with me. And then when I next try and convince people to do something crazy in Spark, I can have some more real world style applications besides word count. the word count example looks very nice, but I mean, at the end of the day, if you're just doing word count, it's not really that important. So I would really appreciate UDFs from people, and we can use this probably more in sort of our error-related work. I don't think the Jython work is going to be continuing forward unless things change substantially. If there is like a Jython person in the audience that really wants to work on it, like, we can work together, but it's probably not going to go into Spark Core. Yay, second question.
Yeah, thank you. I was wondering if you've considered just translating Python code into, Scala code, or I don't know.
Yeah, okay, actually, so this is awesome. Thank you for asking that question. So the answer is sort of. The first step is sort of the DSL, right, where we... Okay, yeah. So the first step is like the select statements and stuff like that. Those essentially get translated into Java code automatically behind the scenes for us. Same thing with the group by and the sum. Like those are all actually happening on the JVM. Although in the future they may actually happen in native code, but those parts will get cross-compiled for free. I did have this really crazy plan of looking at Python bytecode and trying to cross-compile some of it to Java. That project is looking for other people interested in it. More realistically, there's this work on the Scala side to look at Scala code and compiling the Scala code into the DSL. So we would actually probably compile into Spark's DSL rather than into Java code, because Spark's DSL lets Spark have a better understanding of what's going on. And there is an open issue around doing this for really simple statements. Realistically, we probably can't do it for things using libraries like NumPy or stuff like that. But hopefully we can start doing it for simple statements. And this is just, like, I like writing lambda expressions more than I like writing things in a DSL. So this might happen, and there is work towards this. It's just probably not going to be in the next 6 months, which tends to be the time frame that I think about my life, because my longest job is 18 months. So, you know. Are there any other questions?
Yeah. Hello. Thank you for the speech. I have a question about vectorization of computations. For example, if there are any kind of plans, because it's pretty expensive to call function on every sample. For example, you can vectorize computations. Maybe it will be faster.
Totally. That's a great question. So there is work on vectorizing the computations that are expressed in the DSL. And that's actually... I mean, that happens now some of the time already, and it's just a matter of the people working on that having time to vectorize more of the different types of computations. So provided you're willing to write in the DSL rather than arbitrary lambda expressions, that's good. I think to see it for arbitrary lambda expressions, we'd have to see something like Arrow first, which gives us a better sort of memory format, so we don't do the row-based copy approach. We could instead do something more intelligent, but that's probably like a 2.4 type thing for arbitrary lambda expressions. But certainly once we have Arrow, we could probably start using some of the same vectorization stuff on the Python side that the wonderful folks at Continuum are working on. It's just right now it's not super feasible until we change the data store type.
Travis mentioned education and communication. You've produced a lot of written material. Can you speak a little about your process in doing that? Because it seems very intimidating process to put out those books.
Totally. Yeah, so the first time someone asked me to write a book, I said yes because I had no idea what that involved. That book was not very good. It's out of date already, but it was also, it was my first book. I find that working with different publishers actually has a very different experience. And even different editors within the same publisher give you very different amounts of guidance and help. So I've had some really wonderful experiences with some of the O'Reilly folks, with being able to go to them with early ideas and get feedback and suggestions. Because, I mean, I talk to a lot of new people, and it's wonderful, but they also talk to a lot of people that I don't normally talk to, like fancy people that buy Safari subscriptions and stuff like that. And so that's been very useful, working with O'Reilly on that. I mean, if you're interested in writing a book, I think it's... how do I put this? You will make like $0 on your book on a good day. So books are a really terrible investment in terms of like direct return on money. But I find that it makes it a lot easier to like get fun jobs when you wrote the book that someone used to learn the technology they're working with. It also is really hilarious when people quote your book at you incorrectly. I don't know if men have the same experience, but like, I find that incredibly pleasurable. And just like, no, that's not actually what the book said. The process is like just a lot of time, and I think having co-authors makes it doable. There's a lot of authors who would disagree with me. They would say things like, I want to murder my co-author, where the hell is my co-author, and things like this. But I find having a second person to work with makes it a lot easier to hold myself accountable, because like I'm perfectly fine letting myself down, right? Like, I'm used to that. My grades in school clearly demonstrate this. But if I'm working with someone else, I feel really bad if I let them down. And often they feel really bad if they let me down. And then by doing this together, we can both overwork ourselves until the book is finished. And then we never want to speak to each other again for like 6 months. I'm not sure writing books is really the best way to teach. And I don't think it's the best way to start. The first one that I wrote was not very good, I think in part because I hadn't taught any classes face-to-face on the subject matter. I think it's a lot better to do some local small training classes first, and then you will find that the things that people don't understand look nothing like the things you expected them not to understand, and you will change how you want to write your book based on teaching some small classes. And I find teaching some small classes is also a really good way to find out if you and your co-author are going to murder each other, or just like get really close to murdering each other, because there's an important difference between the two. If you want to talk more about books later on, I will be around. Is anyone else thinking about like writing a book? Okay, you're all pretty reasonable people. But like, it's really nice when it's finished. I don't know. It's like, So, I realize there's probably a lot of people in this room who did finish their PhD, and please don't take this the wrong way. But it's like dropping out of a PhD program is like often a sign that that person like is pretty good at doing like cost analysis to see if it's worth it to finish. And I think an important part of writing a book is not being good at cost analysis. And sunk cost fallacy, believing in that, is amazing motivation to finish your book. I would just start with teaching classes and see how that goes. And then if you decide that you hate your life, or that you don't want to see your friends anymore, follow up and write a book. Okay, I think we're out of time, or is there time for, yeah, okay, we're out of time. Thank you so much. I hope this is great.